For this part on our series in fraud detection, we'll be using another type of outlier-based classification approach called DBSCAN. In our last video, we covered our first technique in outlier detection, which used quantiles to help detect credit card fraud. Although it is a great technique for a linearly distributed data, with our use case, it did not perform as well as other techniques due to the skewed distributions in our dataset. For this video in our series on fraud detection, we will address the use case by using the popular clustering algorithm DBSCAN. As we are using an unsupervised algorithm, a labeled dataset is not necessarily needed. However, it is useful to have such a dataset to rate the performance of the model. To train our model to classify transactions, we first read in our data from the Kaggle dataset credit card fraud detection. We do some minor pre-processing where we change the target column from 0 or 1 to the relevant meanings of good or suspicious. We apply the Z-score normalization on all the numeric columns to help standardize the scale of the features in our dataset. When we go to the row sampling node, we only take 10% of the samples. Now, why do we do this? We want to only train the algorithm on 10% of our data. The main reason is really because of the compute required by the DBSCAN algorithm. The more data we pass to it, the time it takes to execute increases in log linear time. If you are familiar with time complexities, the DBSCAN algorithm runs at the same complexity as many of the popular sorting algorithms. We will go more in depth on some of the differences in results depending on how much data we pass in on the next slide. Here's the view of the score node. We have a confusion matrix that shows the overall performance of the model. We can see the correctly classified transactions and the mistakes. At the bottom, we can see an accuracy of 98%, which is much better than our last technique used in quantiles. What if we run it on 100% of our initial data? If you recall, we only use 10% of our sample data through the DBSCAN algorithm. Let's pull up an image from the same score node of a previous run, but with all the data passed to the DBSCAN node. As you can see, they are almost the same in performance. This brings up an interesting question of how much data do we need to run it on? This is a very subjective question, but to prove a point, we are able to achieve essentially the same results without having to run it on all the data. Keep in mind, the time to execution on the left side was significantly longer than the one on the right. The 10% row sampling took a couple seconds to execute while using all the data brought it to about 3 minutes to finish executing. Depending on your use case, you may not need to use as much data as you think. Now, here's the next workflow that we can use to deploy our trained model on a new transaction. On the left, we can read in our models the DBSCAN output and the new transaction. Next, we apply the normalization model on the transaction. We can then use the output from the DBSCAN and the Euclidean distances to do a similarity search on our new transaction. From here, we can determine whether it is fraudulent. At the end, the send email component will send an email out if a fraudulent transaction is detected. You can download these workflows on the KNIME for Finance space under Audit and Compliance. Feel free to check out our previous techniques used for fraud detection.